Oh, sorry. I thought I had a hemorrhoid and wanted to see how bad it was. Is everything okay with my pictures? No Reddit's top 5 malicious compliance. Number 5, my aunt told me to warm up her cheesecake, so I did. This happened when my aunt still lived with me. I had just gotten done making a cheesecake for my mom's birthday. It was a raspberry cheesecake, my mom's favorite. After we were all done dinner, I brought out the cheesecake and we all yelled happy birthday. I cut the cake and gave everyone a piece. Not even 10 seconds after putting down the plate, my aunt said, "It's too cold. Heat it up." I just looked at her and said, "You're not supposed to heat up cheesecake." She just scoffed and said, "Shut up and just heat it up." I was already pissed off at her that day because she kept making fun of my tattoos, so I just said, "Fine, I'll heat it up." When I went into the kitchen, she yelled, "Make sure it's hot." I just smiled to myself and said, "Don't worry. I'll make sure it is." I then put the piece of cheesecake in a small bowl and put it in the microwave for 7 minutes. When it was done, I took it out of the microwave and it was a bubbling, boiling, hot bowl of cheesecake soup. I grabbed a spoon, I brought it out and put it on the table in front of my aunt. When my aunt saw the bowl, she just stared at it, but when my mom saw it, she started laughing her ass off. My aunt looked at me and quietly said, "What is this?" I just smiled and said, "You said you wanted it hot, so there you go." I just sat down and ate my piece of cheesecake as my aunt stared at her bowl. My aunt never told me to heat up her food again. Number 4, dear servers, the customer is always right and you should be grateful to have a job. I work at a theater. When a play has its premiere, there are always a bunch of people, including journalists, sponsors, and a lot of bougie elitists who believe they own the place. So this story takes place during one of these premieres. Me and two other girls are working at the counter, selling drinks and doing the catering stuff. We are all pretty young, in our mid-20s, and that's why some visitors think we are pushovers and they can just make us bend certain rules for them. Shortly before the beginning of the play, this encounter ensues. Rabi is my co-worker and Karen is obviously the bitch here. Sorry to all the nice Karens out there. Karen, hi, I would like to order a glass of this red wine, it's the most expensive item on our menu. Rabi, sorry, I can't sell you anything right now, the play starts in 3 minutes and you are not allowed to take drinks into the theater. But I could give you a glass of water for free. In Germany you normally have to pay for water, so this was a pretty nice offer. Karen, no, I want the wine. Rabi, are you sure you want to down 0.2 liter of it in, looks at the clock, 2 minutes? I mean, I can give it to you right after the play, when we also open the buffet. Karen, I want white wine with the food, so give me the red one now. That you even have the guts to argue with me about this. How dare you? Do you even know who I am? I pretty much own this place, so I also pretty much own you, and you should be grateful for your job, little girl. If you misbehave like this, I'll let Alex, our boss, know. Blah blah blah. Rabi, who actually already quit because she is moving and this is her last shift, okay? Sure. Your wish is my command. She pours her the glass of wine and takes the money, and Karen walks away with a big smirk on her face. 1 second after that, our shift manager comes and we open the door to the theater room and check the tickets to let people in. When it's Karen's turn to go in, she tries to sneak by Rabi and me with the full glass of wine. Rabi stops her, gives her her best customer service smile and says, "Sorry, drinks are not allowed in here," and triumphantly takes the glass and walks away. Karen looks really pissed and I just stand there and try not to laugh too much. I know this was just a small little victory, but if you are a server and you always have to be like super nice no matter how people treat you, it feels really good to get the chance to give back sometimes, smiley face. BTW, sorry for any spelling mistakes or for my writing in general, I'm on mobile and English isn't my first language. Number 3, don't want us to do it the right way. Alright. You're the boss. Hello friends. This is a happy little story from my time as a warehouse assistant. Some background first, this happened while working for a small business. The boss in question is actually a great dude, but like all bosses, he's under a ton of stress and has his moments. This particular piece of compliance revolves around a nail gun in use in the warehouse. Don't worry, no idiots were harmed in the writing of this story, so every afternoon we have pretty large shipments getting sent out. Everything sold for the day would be popped onto pallets and shipped off to customers. Now pallets are surprisingly expensive and if not sized properly cost a fortune extra in freight. So we eventually started making our own in order to fit the size of the products being shipped using the previously mentioned nail gun to put them together. All was going well until the delivery guy told us that, and I quote, "Those F-King pallets of yours are SHT and keep falling apart, stop using the F-King nail gun and put them together properly." We looked into it and he was 100% right. See, the nails from the nail gun were super small, thin, and couldn't grip for SH*T. The warehouse manager could actually pull the pallets with his hands. So yeah, not good. 'Twas reported to the admin folks upstairs and the show went on. From that point on we started using normal nails instead, yet it took longer but we were still saving money and the deliver folks were happy as clams. Now for the turn. One Friday, late in the afternoon, the boss comes down and lets us know the sales team has just landed a big one. "Boss, we need some pallets, lads. I want this to ship this afternoon. Grab the nail gun and throw some together ASAP." "Me, no problem, I'll get on it now." Boss goes back upstairs and I start belting pallets together using normal nails. 5 minutes later, boss comes back down and he is fuming. "Boss, OC, I can see you on the cameras. What the hell are you doing?" "Me, hammering the pallets up, boss, as you said." "Boss, I said to use the damn nail gun." "Me, well I would, but when we used it last TI." "Boss, no buts. We bought that nail gun, now you better bloody use it. In fact, I'll show you how." Boss man takes the nail gun and slaps together a pallet in 20 seconds flat. Normally takes about 3 more minutes by hammer. "Boss, there, see, now do it the right way or go home." "Me, yes boss." And so begins our compliance. I pick up the nail gun and smash out 5 fragile pallets in the space of about 3 minutes. Exactly the same way the boss man did, which I'm okay with, it's a ton easier. All while my co-workers giggled with glee. Come shipping time, I realize just why they were all giggling. All the other forklift users are out for the rest of the afternoon. With local deliveries, sickness, and general excuses. The only person with a fork license whom was going to have to load the truck was, you guessed it, boss man. So boss man picks up the first pallet, and is about to load it onto the truck when the pallet is hit by a stray breeze and proceeds to fall apart on the forks. "Delivery guy, the FK did I tell you about those pallets? Are you idiots using that nail gun again?" Boss stammers, saying we needed them sent this afternoon and the nail gun should have done the job. "Delivery guy, I don't bloody care. I cannot take any of the pallets you've built with that nail gun. If they fall apart in our possession and damage something or someone, it's a bloody nightmare. Do M again and I'll pick M up tomorrow." And with that parting gift, in his own act of compliance, the delivery driver keeps to his word, closes the truck and drives off without our shipment. The boss sits in silence, contemplating the thousands of dollars in product which has now experienced a nice big shipping delay. "Did I mention this was Friday?" "Boss, OC." "Me, yeah boss." "Boss, retire the nail gun, and sorry about earlier." "Me, don't worry about it. Want a hand getting all these back inside?" "Boss, yep, and if you've got some time before closing I would appreciate some fresh pallets as well." "Me, on it. I'll have M knocked up in a bit." And the nail gun was never heard from again. Don't you all enjoy a happy ending? TLDR, why are you here if you ain't reading the stories? Number 2, military spouse accuses me of cheating on my husband, with my husband. I've been living in Japan for a little over 2 years with my husband. He was born here and we decided to move to his hometown. It's a small city, but there's enough to do without getting bored. I'd describe us as an AMWF couple, Asian man, white female for those who don't know. It's not so common in Western countries, and it can feel like we are some rare shiny Pokemon as AMWF in rural Japan. Lots of staring, occasional secret picture, or even small chats if an old lady is brave enough to approach us. It can feel uncomfortable eating at a restaurant because kids will turn around in their seat and stare at us the whole time with an open fish mouth. Coincidentally, there's a small US military base located in the city. The closer you are downtown, the more American families you see. I'm constantly mistaken for being military by Americans and Japanese, which is understandable. Besides myself, I only know 5 other interracial marriages here. It's always locals who ask about my American husband when I'm out alone, which I respond in Japanese, Watashi no Ato wa Nihon Shin desu. Koko ni Sundi imasu, my husband is Japanese and I live here, or something along those lines. Americans never ask about my marriage as they assume my spouse is American. When we are together in public, we do abnormal couples behavior such as holding hands. No, couples rarely hold hands in public, let alone say I love you. We don't go downtown too often since it's all pay to park and it's a nightmare to find a place. It was a beautiful warm day for the first time in months, but we decided to battle for a spot and walk around the shops. The crowd was heavy since the weather was great and winter was ending. The season for new American families to move here just finished, so I'm sure this was many people's first time to leisurely walk and shop outside. We find a parking spot and made our way to the outside shops. Of course, we are holding hands and casually talking and laughing. Wow. I hear this from an American woman about 10 feet behind us. You should know that a Japanese stereotype against Americans is that we are rudely and obnoxiously loud. And this wow was loud enough for me to turn my head around at the noise. She was with 2 other moms who had 3 kids each. They were staring at me, but perhaps we just accidentally had eye contact at the right time. Seriously, another little homewrecker is doing this in public. Chill woman, you're so loud even I can hear you. We find a table nearby at the Starbucks outside. We are enjoying our drinks when the same group of women approached us with their strollers in tow. They definitely had some sort of purpose with something to say to us. Let's call her Anna, woman in Japanese. Anna, excuse me, but you need to keep whatever you're doing in your messed up home. Doing that in public in front of families to see is disgusting and immoral. My kids don't need to see such a bad display of marriage. I'm so confused, as was my husband who can speak English. Who knew drinking coffee outside was a crime against humanity and marriage? Me, I am sorry. What did we do? Anna, you know exactly what you're doing. She points to my wedding ring. Me, no, I don't. Anna, good Lord, does your husband know about this? Is he on a ship right now? That's so like a dependipotamus. Her friends laugh. In case you don't speak military, a dependipotamus is slang for a military wife who stays at home all day, doesn't clean, uses their spouse as an ATM, and looks like Jabba the Hutt. It dawns on me, she thinks I'm a military spouse and I'm cheating on my American husband. I started laughing because she's suggesting I'm cheating on my husband, with my husband. Me, this is my spouse. I'm actually not part of the military community and have a Japanese visa. Anna looks at my significant other up and down. The 2 women behind her apologize, but the Anna didn't believe it. Anna, no one would voluntarily want to live in this little town. Nice lie, but you're not representing the military community. You make all of us wives look like whores. Who is your husband and what's his rank? Also, I need to your dependent ID. My husband is a high rank, so he'll make sure your husband is aware of your infidelity. She pulls out her phone to probably type my response. I'm offended since this is actually a nice place to live and very open to foreigners. Me, look, my husband's name is Rei, not his real name, I don't want to reveal personal info, and he's sitting right here. I'm not going to show you my military ID since I don't have one, and you're not the police. As proof, you can obviously see our wedding band's match and here's a picture. I show her my phone screen which is of us in traditional Japanese clothes on our wedding day. Her eyes became huge at the picture. Her two friends and their spawn have already started walking away. Anna, why are you in a relationship with him? You should be in a normal relationship and start having a family with American kids. She says some other statements which I'd consider racist against the Asian race. It's so ironic because we are in Japan, and she's fussing about me being married to a Japanese man. My husband has been quiet throughout the whole exchange and says to me we should go. I agree and stood up. Me, stop. The things you are saying are extremely offensive. I was part of the military community myself some years ago and what you're doing is against spousal conduct. She smirked. Go ahead and tell people what I did, then. My high-ranking husband is an E7, and everything will be swept under the rug no matter what happens. You can't touch me. So that's what I did. Note, this is a small military community. Someone does something minor and it's talked about between wives like chickens. Later that day, I run into my friend who works on the base and she's well known in the community for being one of the main event coordinators. I don't miss this chance to comply with Anna's demand, and explain to my friend about the exchange and how it made my husband extremely uncomfortable with her remarks. She asked me if this person looked like so and so, which I said yes. My friend rolls her eyes. Friend, she just arrived a couple months ago and is already causing problems with rumors and drama. Looks like we have a racist, too. I'll make sure what she said is passed on. It's been half a year later and I didn't hear anything about Anna again since I distanced myself from making military friends here. I've only been in my new city for a little over 2 years and experienced more drama from military families than I have my whole high school career. That is, until now. Last week, I ran into my friend who's getting ready to leave back to the United States. We had a little discussion about her moving and my family planning, and dropped a bombshell. Friend, do you remember Anna, who accused you of cheating on your non-existent military spouse and called your husband a racist name? Me, of course. I haven't heard anything from her since. Friend, well, I mentioned we were already having problems with her not long after she got here. I told my boss that there's a person who was bothering and threatening civilians and asking for IDs which isn't allowed for someone with her status. My boss was extremely interested after I mentioned her name because Anna was scheduled for an interview in my department. I suggested we look at her social media accounts from her past behavior, because we don't tolerate racism. It was easy to find her Twitter and Facebook, particularly Facebook since we have many mutual friends. Her SNS was shocking. While she set her Facebook to private, her Twitter was littered with malicious tweets and retweets. This included racism slang for many nationalities, colorful language, and using her husband's military rank to bully others. She made it very clear that she wants to see her current city burn to the ground and why would anyone want to learn Japanese since it sounds terrible. We printed some of the more extreme things she posted and we still invited her to the interview. Oh, and did I mention my boss is Japanese? So she comes into the interview which I was part of. I asked three good things about her which is she says dependent, gets things done, and friendly. My boss just looked at her for a second before he pulled out her tweets and asked her to explain how she can friendly serve the local community if she hates it so much. Anna was floored and said someone hacked into her account, despite there being at least 3 years of slanderous tweets. We thanked her for coming and said we can't accept an employee with this conduct. As far as I know, she's still not working because some spouses found her Twitter not long after the interview and was shared in all departments. No one will touch her application now. Me, So all of this was discovered because I told you about her accusations. Friend, yes. Oh, and she's kind of an outcast socially right now because she cheated on her husband a couple months ago. There you have it, folks. Because one person couldn't mind their own business, they lost a potential job and had their social media exposed. Super ironic, since she became the dependipotamus and adulterer, the same thing she was accusing me of. Number one, security made us show the last 5 photos on our phone. My coworker, an absolute hero, maliciously complied at security on one of our subcontractor jobs. The customer was a manufacturer for high-end electronic components. Security was tight as a small 4x6 box could contain $250,000 worth of microchips. Our team was installing equipment in their facility for 1 week. A security checkpoint had to be passed every trip in or out of the building. Mr. Security Guard, Chad maybe, decided my coworker, Steve probably, was more suspicious than the other 4 techs. So every trip in or out, not only was Steve made to dump his entire contents of his backpack out on the table and go through it, Chad required Steve to show him the last 5 pictures taken on his phone to prove he wasn't stealing secrets. This is all fine, except Chad lets everyone else through without any sort of inspection. Steve is trying to stay positive, but obviously this is eating away at him. Steve tries to be overly positive and also a bit snarky with comments like "Thank you, Paul Blart, for keeping America safe," which busts up the rest of our crew. Then, Steve has the idea that will free him the rest of the week. Wednesday comes along, Steve is overly scrutinized on our way in as usual. As we head to security at lunch, Steve says he has to go to the bathroom. He comes back out a few minutes later, absolutely giddy. Chad Blart, mall cop, stops us on our way out and asks Steve to see his camera roll. Steve gladly hands the phone over. Chad is greeted by some very peculiarly angled shots of Steve's butthole. What the f at percent dollar? Chad throws the phone down on the table. Oh, sorry. I thought I had a hemorrhoid and wanted to see how bad it was. Is everything okay with my pictures? Is the facility safe? Chad never checked Steve's materials again. Good on you, Steve.